So I asked to give a story about the journey towards peace. And so the way I want to talk about Friendship Force is really in two segments. One is a journey towards peace that will start with something very personal. Also, I'm going to talk a little bit about the journey of peace that Friendship Force has been on and why our organization is so incredibly important today. And then I'm going to get a little bit operational by talking about what is Friendship Force doing right now to set ourselves up for the next 40 years. And I think many of you members of the Sacramento Club who have been around for a while, you also want to hear that too. Where, not only where have we been, but where are we going and how are we going to get there? So that's a little bit of the outline of today's talk. So, when I thought about the journey towards peace, I thought about my sister Sarah. And that is me at the very top. That's my sister Sarah in the middle. She's 5 years younger than me. And then my other sister Megan, she's 10 years younger than me. And Sarah and I were always at each other's throats growing up. I don't know how many of you have siblings. I'm sure that we were very unique in that way, having sibling rivalry and that sort of thing. We were always at each other's throats. And it always started with something like, hey, what? Hey, don't look at me like that. Look at me like what? Like this? Don't look at me like that. And then it elevate to a little bit of poking and prodding, and then eventually we'd be all out screaming. And every single time it ended with one of two things happening, depending on where we were. Either we were kicked out of the house, and then my mother would close the door and lock it. We lived out in the woods in rural New Hampshire. Go fend for yourself for a few hours and come back and get along. Or if we were in the car, maybe this is illegal now, who knows? We were told to get out and walk home. You guys can get out and you can walk the rest of the way. I don't care how long it takes you. So when I hear things like how to walk up a hill backwards or 3 feet of snow, I was there doing that as a small child. Way back in the day. But we also knew that the journey towards peace had to come with some kind of reward. And so when Sarah and I had some kind of a common goal, that peace always seemed to come by a little bit faster. Hey, Sarah, you want a fudgicle? I mean, how many of you know what a fudgicle is? Fudgicle? Do you have this anymore? Possible. And I would say, well, yeah, me too. I want one. She would say, well, maybe we should talk really nice to each other and Mom will give us a fudgicle. And I would say, okay, let's pretend to love each other and be really, really good. And then show Mom how much I love each other by holding hands. And it always works. And she probably knew we were playing a game. Any parents in the room know that you know when our kids are playing a game. It will take whatever you can get sometime. And so our journey always ended up with us eventually kind of finding peace by our common goal of wanting to have that fudgicle. And so that worked for us. But one of the things that I realized growing up is that never really goes away when you get older. And even though we're adults and we think we should know better and we're more mature and we're more worldly and seasoned, we still have these petty fights, but they're just a little bit different. I heard that Germans are pretty hard people. Germans aren't really hard people. What do you mean by that? I heard they're very particular about time and everything has to be absolutely strictly correct and perfect. Well, that's not true. And I'm German. My parents are German. What are you talking about? Well, I heard Americans were just overly confident. Overly confident. Oh, yeah. I heard they were overly confident about everything. Well, I'm American. I'm not overly confident about everything. What do you mean by that? And before long, you find yourself back in that sibling rivalry kind of conversation about petty things. Until finally somebody says, you know what? They have a 2-for-1 frappuccino over there at Starbucks. Maybe we should go over there and just maybe have a frappuccino and talk things out. So, you know, in many ways, we can find lots of parallels. That's a soft way of talking about some of the divisions that go on in the world. There are many other kinds of divisions that are much more aggressive. But you get my point. These kind of, these petty things often are what lead to ridiculous divisions that can really be healed by approaching it a little bit differently. So what happened, and some of this was shared today, what happened in 1976, the year before Friendship Force was born, Wayne Smith was traveling in Brazil with his family, and he recruited a reporter named John Pruitt. He actually is a retired anchorman in Atlanta, and I met him just a few months ago. He just recently retired and is now freelancing. But he shared a great story about how he was dragged to Brazil while Wayne Smith was talking about this ridiculous idea of the Friendship Force, bringing people together from around the world. And in a sense, what he outlined was exactly what my sister Sarah and I eventually discovered in that fictional story about the German and the American talking to each other. He said, well, what if we flip things around? Rather than waiting until the point where we're angry at each other and then we have to find some reason why we should go get that sweet treat, what if we put the sweet treat first? What if we put friendship first before all the other things? What if we put extending a hand of welcome and let's share a meal together before you get to the place where you're so bitter and divided that you hate people around you? And so that's kind of how the Friendship Force got started. I'm moving along here and I'm realizing I can get off track, and that's never a good thing. So what happened a year after that is in 1977, the Friendship Force was born. And through his connection with Governor Jimmy Carter at the time, he was able to put the Friendship Force on the world map through a promise that Jimmy Carter made when he was president to help establish the Friendship Force in all 50 states. And so that's what happened. And so 40 years later, as you look around, we have this Friendship Force, this organization that has worked tirelessly to put the Frappuccinos and the Fudgicles first, to put Friendship Force first, everything that we're doing, to put discrimination and stereotypes and hatred, to eradicate it through the simple idea of putting friendship first. But when you look at the macro, what goes on in the world, you have to ask yourself, are we really making any progress? What is the relevance of Friendship Force? That's one question I've been getting a lot in the last, certainly the last year, when we start talking about getting to our 40th anniversary and looking at the next 40 years. We've had our time. It started in 1977. Here we are 40 years later. Do we really need an organization like the Friendship Force anymore?
Yeah.
Are you at the end of your seat? Well, what's he going to say? No? No, I'm not going to say that, I promise. The Global Peace Index, this is the 2017 Global Peace Index, talked about the economic loss of violence around the world. And they said that the economic loss of violence and conflict is over $13.6 trillion. 70% of that is from government spending on military and internal security. The remaining amount is through the losses from violence and conflict. $13.6 trillion. The United Nations peacekeeping expenditures for peace, anybody have an idea what that might be? $8.27 billion, a mere 1.1% of the estimated economic losses. Our global yearly spending on war is, anyone want to take a shot at this? $2 trillion. $2 trillion. The U.S. alone spends $1 million. This is not me talking, guys. This is the Global Economic Peace Index. Anybody have an idea about what some of the soft estimates for ending starvation around the world is? This was kind of an interesting thing because it's in stark contrast to these big numbers. $30 billion. To end starvation around the world. These are carefully calculated numbers for how we do things. So why does this happen? Well, there's lots of reasons, and I'm certainly not going to get into those reasons now. I don't want to get political. I don't want to get into talking about government budgets and our positions in the world and that sort of thing. It has a lot to do with the economy. It has a lot to do with shifts politically around the world and being a non-political, non-religious organization, we won't go there. I'm just here to tell you that these are really big numbers that we are fighting against when we start talking about the importance of peace. How many of you may remember this, a little trip down memory lane, this guy named Bob Newhart? Anybody here know about Bob Newhart? He had the Bob Newhart show for years and years. Yeah. Well, he had this, they did this parody on Saturday Night Live some years ago, and it basically, it's a therapy session that he gives somebody, and he tells them some really important advice on how to deal with their major psychological issues. So, let me play that very short clip.
All right. Well, let's go, Catherine. I'm going to say two words to you right now. I want you to listen to them very, very carefully. Then I want you to take them out of the office with you and incorporate them into your life.
Well, shall I write them down?
Well, if it makes you comfortable, it's just two words. Most people can remember them.
Okay.
You ready?
Yes.
Okay, here they are.
Stop it!
I'm sorry?
Stop it!
Stop it?
Yes, S-T-O-P, new word, I-T.
I absolutely love that clip, because when I worked at the residential treatment center, we dealt with a lot of issues, family issues and child issues. It was one stress after another, and this clip really saved us, because it summarizes essentially all the issues that you see in the world. This one says, stop it! Cut it out, please! What are you thinking? Russia said, stop it! President Trump just tweeted, stop it! The world is basically at a point now where they're just saying, please, just stop it. Whatever it is you think you're doing, it's helping, it's not. So please, just stop it. I want to take that stopping just a little bit further for you with Friendship Force. When people have a hard time hosting same-sex couples in their homes, I want to say, stop it! Stop thinking that way. When people from Mexico say they don't want to come to the United States because they're afraid of the wall and what's going to happen with them, I told them to stop it. It's not what we're about. We're not about creating those divisions. When people say, I don't want to travel to the other side of the world because they might not understand their language, stop it. Go. Be a citizen ambassador. It's okay. We've been doing it for 40 years. We proved that it can be done. So if you don't leave anything tonight, if you don't remember anything tonight, remember this one thing. This is what Friendship Force is about. We see conflict, and we see war, and we see division, we see discrimination, we see stereotypes. Just tell them to stop it. Stop. We're humans first, please. I want to take us to another little story, and this has to do with a book called The Business Plan for Peace. And I'm actually trying to get her to come to our next world conference. But Dr. Alworthy, in the beginning of her book, A Business Plan for Peace, actually started the story, or her talk about the business plan for peace, talking about this man named Lieutenant Colonel Chris Hughes. And actually, on the way here, was able to read there was an article online talking about Lieutenant Colonel Chris Hughes and this really phenomenal thing that he did in 2003 when he was in Najaf, Iraq. He and his troops had come into this town. I'm summarizing this for you. He had come into this town, and they wanted to speak to the holy man. They were trying to create, diplomacy, channels of diplomacy in this small town. So they were trying to connect with the right people. So he and his troop had gone into this small town, fully armored, with their guns and with all their helmets and all their equipment. And while they're trying to approach the holy man's house, a small crowd began to gather. And as he was beginning to look for this holy man, the crowd got bigger, and they had to stop in the middle of the street. Then the crowd got even bigger, and soon there were over 100 people, and they started to chant something in Arabic. And they could tell by looking at their faces that they were becoming angrier and angrier. And you could tell that they were angry because of his troops' presence. Now, at this point, some of the people in the crowd had begun to throw rocks at his troops. Now, you would think that the reaction to being aggressed upon would be to show aggressive behavior back. But he did something very different. He ordered his men to take their guns and point them to the ground. Then he ordered his men to all take a knee. All take a knee. And so his men looked around kind of wondering, what is he trying to do? What is he? This is crazy. They're throwing rocks at us. They're yelling and shouting at us. But they all took a knee. And within a couple of minutes, the crowd became very quiet. They started looking at each other. What's going on? This is just strange behavior. And just before long, some of the people started to drift away. And eventually, the crowd completely dispersed. And it was one of those stories that really, I think, exemplifies some of the work that Friendship Force does. It was a gesture of respect and understanding that the local people were looking for. One of the things that Dr. Elworthy talked about in her book was that humiliation is a key driver of violence, and that respect is the strongest antidote to humiliation. And Lieutenant Hughes knew this when he went into this small town. He saw the potential for major bloodshed. And he said, I'm going to look beyond this current situation into what the people need. And in that process, he probably helped save several lives and certainly a very bloody conflict. So what Dr. Elworthy goes on to talk about in her book, after exemplifying the story of peace through uncommon action, is the importance that citizen ambassadors like you and I have when we travel. Because when we travel and we interact with people, we're showing them respect. We're opening up a door for understanding. We're doing something very uncommon. We might be going to a place where they're highlighting it on the news, or they're reading about things in the newspaper, or maybe even there's some history there that gave you a predetermined idea that these people, you know, you're not going to like these people. But through this process of showing respect and understanding and friendship, you're able to heal whole nations, heal people's mindsets, heal people's ability to be able to connect with people on a human-to-human level. And that's what Dr. Elworthy was trying to discuss, or trying to share in this book. I want to shift gears, if I can, to talk a little bit about Friendship Force as a whole. Where are we right now? Well, we just got done celebrating our 40th anniversary in Manchester. And one of the great things that we got to celebrate in Manchester were all the people that helped make this organization great, as we honored at the very beginning of tonight. Former President Jimmy Carter wrote a letter that was shared and read at the conference. Susie Smith, the daughter of Wayne and Carolyn Smith, was there offering her words of encouragement and endorsement for the next 40 years. It really was an absolutely phenomenal moment. We also had pre-recorded thanks from local dignitaries from Atlanta up through the state government. But the real heroes at the World Conference weren't all these people that we were highlighting about from the past or the people that we had brought in through video. It was the over 300 participants, Friendship Force members, who were there because they believed at one point that friendship or peace through friendship was really important, and they dedicated their time to be able to travel around the world and build the organization to make it what it is today. And all these people were there just to give thanks. So what has been happening? We have 360 clubs, we have 15,000 members around the world. We know that our work is important because we've seen how much war and conflict can create as far as economic losses and personal losses. We know that what we have to do is important, but how can we become more effective? One of the last things I shared in Manchester before we wrapped up was the need to expand, was the fact that 15,000 members is really great, but what we need as an organization is 30,000 members. Well, 360 clubs is fantastic. What we really need is 800, 900 clubs in the world. The population continues to increase. Divisions are continuing to create. They're beginning to create new divisions in the world through globalization. Fractures that existed 40 years ago no longer exist, but new fractures exist. Friendship Force is needed more today probably than ever before. If we don't recognize that importance, then we're going to lose a really critical tool in being able to help heal nations, the work that you have been doing for the last 40 years. But we have a problem. And to introduce the problem, I want to share a short video. See this record, this thing talking about. Has anybody ever seen Down by the Honor? Maybe? I said Jim Carter. That wasn't Jimmy Carter, by the way. That was no, I'm not going to do the whole song right now. But how many of you have seen Jimmy Carter? How many of you have seen Jimmy Carter? How many of you have seen Down Abbey? How many of you love Down Abbey? I did too. I watched the whole thing. In fact, when I had that high stress job working with the at the Residential Treatment Center, I had my ringtone on my phone tuned to the Down Abbey theme song just to kind of take the edge, because I knew that when they were going to call me, it was going to be something really bad. So I was like, okay, it's okay. It's just another drama, another Down Abbey drama that we can deal with. But that's not the parallel I want to draw with Down Abbey. One of the great things about watching the entire series was to watch the transformation. transformation that took place from season to season. And you start out with horse and carriage, and then eventually they got cars. You start out with candles and oil lamps, and eventually they got electricity. They start out with carrier pigeons, and well, they didn't start with carrier pigeons, but you know, sending notes through by people hand delivering it. And by the end of the season, they had electronic messages that were being shared. It was a remarkable transformation. If you have not seen Downton Abbey, by the way, I recommend it to you. It's on PBS. You can probably download all of it for free on Amazon. I'm not really sure. And when I look at Friendship Force, like what's been happening with Friendship Force the last, certainly the last probably 5 to 10 years, but in my time, the last 2 years, I've thought about this challenge that we have in trying to reach more people with our mission and start new clubs with our mission in new cities to help expand what has made Friendship Force great. But we have a problem. The computer that we had at Friendship Force when I came there, the one that was managing all of the data from years of exchanges with personal information and all kinds of stuff, was on a server, didn't quite look like that, pretty darn close, was on a server on an old computer that had Windows XP 95 plugged in to a socket in the closet of the office, and it was basically on life support. And we kept it there because there were no updates available, the computer was going out of date, there was nobody offering any support to Windows XP, but all of the organization's prime information was on this server. So this is Downton Abbey of the old right here. We were on some outdated technology, and that's what led to the I'm In campaign, and many of you helped contribute towards, which has basically saved all our data. We had all these things on our desk called Rolodexes. How many of you have those? I actually had a Rolodex in the beginning part of my career. So I learned that you don't have to memorize 15 numbers of your closest friends anymore. You can just tell Siri to call somebody. Everybody at Friendship Force had Rolodexes on their desks right next to their electric typewriters to fill in those forms. Matthew in finance was using an abacus to manage all the money that came in from the fees and the membership fees. I went in there, and I swear, in the finance department, there were 10 different major abacuses all up on the wall, and they were shifting all these things back and forth, trying to make the calculations for the interact process and doing budget projections. Allison, who may be somebody you might know, was leaning out the window when I came in one morning. She was catching the carrier pigeon, receiving notes from all the clubs around the world. This was Friendship Force when I walked through the door over 2 years. Slight exaggeration. So Friendship Force, a lot like Downton Abbey, we have our whole back office systems that were just incredibly out of date. Our database was on life support. We were using old systems to support new data. And at the same time, clubs were saying, what can Friendship Force headquarters do to help me in my club recruit new members and talk about the mission? And what I couldn't tell clubs at the time was, that is so not on my radar right now. What I'm trying to do is get a new computer up and running to take the Rolodex and scan all the business cards into Siri on the computer and to make everything more current. Because if we don't have a back office, if we don't have a headquarters that's using the latest technology to be as efficient as it can be with the limited money that we have, we're of no help to anybody. And one of the key investments that headquarters have had to do in the last 2 years especially, but we've needed for over 10, since the Carters have kind of faded off into the distance, is we need strong brand awareness. We need marketing and public relations on a whole new level so we can begin to talk about Friendship Force again with that kind of supporting us. So then we talk to people and if you tell them about Friendship Force, they'll say, I never heard of Friendship Force. One thing I would love for this organization, I would love as an organization to see gone in the next 3 to 5 years, is the phrase, the best kept secret. I cannot stand that phrase, the best kept secret. It should not be the best kept secret. Friendship Force should be the first thing that people think about when they think about citizen ambassadors and citizen diplomacy. But in order to make it happen, we need strong back office support. So let me very quickly go through some of the things we've been working on at headquarters to help get us set up for the next 40 years. One is, I already mentioned it, we need to embrace the latest technology. Let me tell you just a little bit about the database that's coming online. It has been in the last year. We've always communicated in English. I don't know how many of you know this, but Friendship Force International is not just reaching all English people around the world, English-speaking people around the world. We commonly have to translate critical information into 7 major languages. There are over 20 languages that are represented within Friendship Force, major languages that are represented within the Friendship Force family. We've always only communicated in English. We want to improve communication. We want to improve connectedness between clubs. We want to improve the sharing of critical information around journeys and about stories of friendship, and we want to share information that can be used in public relations. We need to become a multilingual organization. The database is going to allow us to do that. This database that we have will allow everybody who interacts with the database to choose one of, I think, 26 different languages to change the whole back-end information into. But it's also going to serve as a repository for all the great things that Friendship Force clubs have been doing for 40 years. We don't need to reinvent the wheel. We don't need to create new booklets for how to be a good host or how to be a good ambassador, or what's an ambassador, what being a good Friendship Force ambassador is. We don't need to do a lot of the training materials. You've already developed them, but we need to consolidate them in one place, our database can help us with that. We need to build stronger international partnerships. In the last year and a half, we've reached out to organizations like Rotary International, Sister Cities, Visitors Bureau, that's a part, International Visitors Bureau, that's a part of a lot of major cities, and sometimes it's called different things in different cities. And Georgia is the Georgia International Visitors Council. We've reached out to a lot of other organizations as well, smaller organizations that have a similar mindset of let's connect people on a global level with the purpose of peace through friendship. Through these partnerships, we're hoping to open up Friendship Force to larger groups. Lifelong learners, for example, that are associated with many universities around the world are made up of people that fit the profile of Friendship Force to a T. These are people who want to travel and immerse themselves in the culture and learn about other people and the purpose and the hope of establishing new friends. We want to open up our mission. That means we want to make our mission accessible, even if it's for a one-time experience. While you're a working young person with 2 children and only 3 days available to go and do something, we want to give you a Friendship Force experience. Why? Well, even though you might not be ready today to join a club, many Friendship Force members have come back to the organization later in life because they had an experience when they were younger. Maybe some of you in the room had an experience at one point in your life, but now you've come back because you have the time, the dedication, you want to make this a part of your everyday life. Of course, we want to strengthen clubs, and I could go on all night about the things we're doing to strengthen clubs. But strengthening our existing clubs and using clubs like the Friendship Force of Sacramento as a model for other clubs that might be struggling one of the things I would like headquarters to be doing moving forward. How do we take the best of what Friendship Force of Sacramento is doing and replicate it, making it a model that can help train other clubs in doing? We are beginning to do that, but I want to take it up a notch. The other, of course, I want to equip membership. How many of you have a login and a password to at least one other site online? At least one site. If you have a Facebook account, you have a login and a password. If you do online banking, you have a login and a password. I think not many of you raised your hands, but I'm pretty confident that all of you, most of you or all of you, have a login and a password to get access to more information, share more, maybe personal information. Friendship Force International does not have that, but the Friendship Force of Sacramento does. Pretty remarkable. There's a whole wealth of information that we just can't make available to members because right now, if it's public, it's hacked. It needs to be behind some kind of a firewall where it can be protected. That's part of what the database is going to be doing. We're modernizing us. We're taking us from down Abbey to where we're at today with what we're doing. So there's a lot of really exciting things that are coming down the road. Already said that. I hate talking about the operations. I kind of feel like I'm a broken record sometimes talking about what's Friendship Force doing. That's the number one question that I get asked when I travel. So you're the CEO, we know about our mission, it's really important, and I want you to tell us about how important our mission is. But I really want to know, because I'm a member and I care about where we're going as an organization, what are you doing to make sure that we're going to be around for the next 40 years? So I apologize if some of you might go like, oh my gosh, the operation stuff. I tried to make that as exciting as I could with Downton Abbey. But I want to tell you one final thing, though, before I kind of wrap up. Why is this important? Why is any of this really important? And I alluded to this a little bit before in the talk when I talked about how much money we're spending on war and how much we're not spending on peace. But organizations like the Friendship Force are unique because it allows everyday citizens, anybody, to engage in the very important work of citizen diplomacy. And it doesn't take much to be able to do that. You open up your home to somebody new. You open up your heart to a new way of thinking. You open up your mind to a new way of thinking about other people, and your heart to a new way of feeling about other people. That is what makes Friendship Force special. And when you look at things like Airbnb trying to sell experiences, I'm for it. I think it's great. That's fantastic. It is not the Friendship Force. It is not the Friendship Force. They're selling a bed and an experience, which we all want to do, and maybe many of us use Airbnb. But what makes Friendship Force unique is we're giving people the opportunity to connect on a heart-to-heart level. Friendship Force is also that we also are the pioneers of a very important word, and it's called friend or friendship. And so when I hear things like, we're friends on Facebook, I cringe just a little bit because I go, really? You and 400 people on Facebook account are your friends? And when we get to, what happens over time is we begin to lose the impact of these words in our life. Friendship, what does that really mean? Well, I have 500 friends and they all like me on Facebook. That means something, right? But you know, that doesn't mean anything. Friendship Force is the pioneers in establishing what a friend really means. When we talk about friendship, we're not talking about liking you on Facebook. We're talking about connecting and extending our family. That's another part of what makes Friendship Force really special, is that we're not just friends, but eventually these friends become extended family. And we start talking about our extended family, who might be German or Japanese, or might be Moroccan, or might be South American, Peruvian, or Brazilian. You start talking about them from a real level, a real personal connection level. And it's that that's going to change the world. It's that way of thinking that's going to change the world for future generations. And I'm so proud to be a part of it with you. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate being here.